evening. I'm Noel Lateef, president of the Foreign Policy Association and an adjunct professor here at the Zicklin School of Business. And on behalf of the FPA and Baruch, I'd like to welcome you this evening to the Great Decisions Lecture Series with a terrific panel on prospects for Korean reunification. I want to also say that we're delighted that Ambassador Kim, Gheewhan Kim, is here. Ambassador Kim spoke to my class and wowed the group. His knowledge of all things related to the Korean Peninsula, but also to trade in the Pacific region is very impressive. And he's doing a wonderful job as the Consul General of South Korea here in New York. Our editors were prescient when they chose last spring to highlight the Korean Peninsula in the annual Great Decisions briefing book. It seems that not a day goes by without a new story about North Korea, including front page stories in both the Washington Post and the New York Times. Several have featured the permanent representative of Japan to the United Nations, His Excellency Motohide Yoshikawa, who is with us today. Ambassador Yoshikawa, welcome. Our moderator this evening is Evans Revere, who has extensive experience in negotiations with North Korea. How many people can say that? Evans has had a great career at the State Department and served as the Deputy Chief of Mission in Seoul. He was also posted in Japan, China, Taiwan. He is currently a senior advisor at the Albright Stonebridge Group. Evans, I'll turn to you to formally introduce the panel.
Thank you very much, Noel. And good evening to all of you. Thank you all for coming here to this wonderful facility. I've been working on Korea, around Korea, in Korea, regarding Korea for about 47, almost 48 years now. And the developments that we're going to talk about tonight are some of the most significant in my recollection in dealing with this obviously hot topic. And to help discuss this topic, I could not be happier than to have the gentleman to my left on the stage with me tonight. Distinguished friends and experts and colleagues, some of quite long standing. Their names are up on the screen, so you can read that for yourself. But let me just say that the gentleman that we have here, I've had the pleasure and honor of working with for many years. Patrick Cronin, obviously representing the Center for New American Security, a superb regional expert, not just on the Korean Peninsula, but on other subjects as well. Scott Snyder and I have been joined at the hip working on Korea issues for a number of years now. We've participated in a number of fora over the years together. We have gotten to the point now, I think, we're probably channeling each other's thoughts when it comes to dealing with Korean Peninsula issues. And of course, we're tremendously honored to have Ambassador Kim Gheewhan, the Consul General of the Republic of Korea, here tonight to provide the all-important Republic of Korea perspective on things. I was remarking as we were chatting before the program began that if we had conducted this forum this evening 48 or 72 hours ago, the dialogue might have gone very differently than I suspect it's going to go tonight. And what, you might ask, has changed in the meantime? Well, if you have not seen it or read it or heard about it, there has been an absolutely amazing speech delivered by the President of the Republic of Korea, Park Geun-hye, which has set a new course in South Korean policy with respect to North Korea. Which will be one of the topics that I know we'll be talking about tonight. But let me just very quickly set the stage, assuming there's somebody in the audience who's been living on another planet or who's been in forced monastic seclusion. You may not have heard, but I'm sure everybody else in the audience has heard about the developments recently on the Korean Peninsula, not the least of which, of course, happened on the 6th of January when North Korea conducted its fourth underground nuclear test, a test that took place at a test site not too far from the Chinese border. It was a test of roughly 10 megatons in size, significant size. The North Koreans claimed that it was a test of a hydrogen bomb. Clearly, it was not, based on the size of it. They make lots of assertions that are not always true, but it was indeed a successful nuclear weapons test, the fourth time that they've done that, and they did it in very short order from the time they started working on the preparations to the time that they actually conducted the test. And this is further evidence of the ongoing success that North Korea is having in building up a nuclear weapons capability, a nuclear weapons capability that the North Koreans have said publicly, frequently, that they are prepared to use against the United States, the Republic of Korea, Japan, and other countries. And almost as if to remind us of their ambitions in the nuclear arena, a month later, on February 7th, the North Koreans carried out what they described as a satellite launch using a rocket missile, a launch vehicle, that in the eyes of most experts that I've talked to is the same sort of launch vehicle that they would use for an intercontinental ballistic missile that will eventually carry a nuclear weapon over intercontinental distances. The international community's reaction to all of that has been, as you have noted, powerful, strong, and fairly united. Universal condemnation, calls for new UN Security Council resolutions, individual actions by a number of countries, not the least of which are the United States, the Republic of Korea, and Japan. The thrust of those actions, particularly the American actions that have been discussed, is a desire to put an unprecedented level of pressure on North Korea to compel or convince North Korea to come back to the negotiating table and to re-engage with the international community and to resume implementing the commitments that it has already made to give up its nuclear weapons program. That's the goal of the policy that you see being discussed right now in Washington. That is one of the goals of the steps that are being adopted by the United States in a new piece of congressional legislation that is sitting on President Obama's desk, waiting for his signature probably any moment now. There have been other steps that the United States has taken and that our allies, the Republic of Korea and Japan, have taken that we will get into. And one of those steps that our South Korean allies have taken has been the closure of something called the Kaesong Industrial Complex, an industrial complex in which Korean managers, Korean supervisors, and Korean manufacturers are using North Korean labor, were using North Korean labor to produce goods in an effort to try to change the ways and the mindset of North Koreans. The Republic of Korea just a few days ago announced that that project would be closed and finished and ended. That is the last vestige of what you may remember was often described as the sunshine policy of dealing with North Korea. South Korea has taken some other steps, and those steps were spelled out and referred to in President Park's excellent speech on Tuesday, which I commend to you. But perhaps the most important thing that was announced in that speech was a dramatic shift in South Korean policy towards North Korea. A shift away from an emphasis on reconciliation, a shift away from an emphasis on North-South cooperation, the argument being, as she made in her speech, that these things were not working and would not work, and an emphasis instead on sending a very clear message to North Korea that if it continues on the course that it is on, it will lead to the collapse of North Korea. It's a very dramatic language, and once again, I commend that speech to you. With that as a bit of downbeat background, we are here to discuss prospects for Korean reunification. You can well imagine what all of these developments suggest in terms of the likelihood of Korean reunification. But before you jump to conclusions, let's have a discussion about all of these things. And to lead off the discussion of prospects for reunification, particularly in this new and dramatically new context that I have just presented to you, let me ask Dr. Patrick Cronin to lead off. Please, Patrick.
Evans, thank you very much for the moderation and the excellent setup of the issues. It's very difficult not to replicate some of the points you just made and to play off of them. In my 10 minutes, permit me to raise five questions or highlight five points. The first one is the question of whether the long standoff on the Korean Peninsula, the decades of seemingly having stasis in terms of not being able to move forward with North-South relations, is this now at a critical turning point? And I think Evans Revere has just raised that possibility, and I think we have to think seriously about that, and we'll be watching carefully in the weeks, months ahead to see whether this is the case. But in just the space of 6 weeks, the ground under our feet has shifted. So we didn't expect when we started 2016 that we'd begin in the first week of the year with this H-bomb of justice as the North Korean propaganda advertised their nuclear test. We didn't think it'd be followed up the next month with a rocket satellite launch. We didn't think that South Korea would respond by closing the Kaesong Industrial Complex or that she would give this fiery National Assembly speech this week. So in this way, South and North Korean policy seems to be shifting. Regardless of what the United States and other countries do, there is shifting going on in Seoul and Pyongyang. And so inter-Korean relations are now not just taut, but also uncertain. So that's the first point I would highlight. The second one is a question that really emanates from President Park's speech in a way. And it asks us to think, is slow change potentially as dangerous as sudden change? She's essentially challenging the assumption that sudden change is what we have to fear. But what happens if gradual change every single day of North Korean policy leads to more nuclear weapons, more missiles, threats of nuclear blackmail, an illicit network of racketeering, systematic suppression of human rights? Is this not Kim Jong-un's policy of slow motion instability? At least it's worth a debate on that question, I would argue. And that's why President Park in her speech said that if events could run their course, yeah, and I could fill in that ellipsis. If events could run their course, I can imagine in the very near future, the next several years, a mobile intercontinental ballistic missile deployed, aiming at US territory, as well as Korea and Japan and others. I can imagine nuclear proliferation becoming a much more real possibility, both in Northeast Asia and beyond. The third point I'd make is the question of, does the mothballing of the Kaesong Industrial Complex represent the end or the beginning of a harsher policy? President Park suggested in her speech, quote, it was just the beginning. Well, just the beginning of what? What are we entering? And that goes back to these other questions that we need to be asking. It seems to be the beginning of the end of trust politique. But here I would argue that there never really was any trust. And it's not very difficult to abandon something when the trust is not building. But engagement, as I will argue at the very end, can't go away. So trust politique may change, but engagement, statesmen, stateswomen cannot afford to abandon that. So the Kaesong had to fall in some ways when the costs of subsidizing weapons of mass destruction became greater than the rewards of contact and engagement. And so this is why I think President Park created uncertainty in the mind of Kim Jong-un, and I think that can be a good thing. Is it a risky thing? Yes, but it can be a good thing because it can actually reinforce deterrence. We do know, though, that the military options are too risky, but we also know that both carrots and sticks, both sunshine policy and sanctions policies, have failed to change North Korea's proliferation course, among other policies. Fourth point is the question of, without gradual negotiated confederation leading to unification, which was the end state of the sunshine policy of Kim Dae-jung in the 90s and the thought behind every other form of engagement, including trust politique in many ways, is it possible to have unification? The question of this conference. Well, I think unification that doesn't erupt into major regional war is a real possibility. That's a controversial statement. It is based on at least a report that we produced, and I have a few hard copies. It's on our website as well at cnas.org, called Solving Long Division, the Geopolitical Implications of Korean Unification. And I think when President Park was saying in her speech this week, when the water level rises, even a small rupture could cause a dam's collapse, she was in many ways saying, look, we cannot predict what's going to happen in this oppressed system. This Kim family regime may well collapse. In fact, the most likely means of change right now in North Korea is either natural death or even more likely a palace coup. It's not likely to be a bottom-up color revolution because there's just too little sort of reach to the provinces and they have too little access. But things will change and they could change very quickly. So we imagine in Solving Long Division a less than cataclysmic unification scenario that could promise a lot of benefits for the future. This is ultimately the bonanza that President Park has also talked about, because a unified Korea in the future, in theory, could be a top 10 economy in the world. It could be nuclear free, it could be democratic, it could be a real major global force for good. That's a possibility. The problem is, what's the pathway to get there? And so we always trip over on that same issue. It's possible, but a lot of bad things could happen en route to that. So the fifth point is this. If Kim Jong-un is undermining peace, you know, how does a statesman, stateswoman respond? How do you impose costs on bad behavior without provoking war? And I think there are three things that are sort of threaded to the current policy. Information is a very strong weapon. President Park vowed to take stronger measures to teach Pyongyang that its nuclear ambitions will only hasten the Kim family regime's demise. But the United Republic of Korea idea that she's also talked about, not in that acronym, has given all Koreans a positive vision to think about that can ultimately bring about change. That's part of the information campaign. There's another more offensive side of information campaign. Let me just suggest rather provocatively that if you read the New York Times or other papers this week, you may have read a report about Nitro Zeus, a classified cyber attack program that the United States apparently developed in the event that the Iran nuclear deal went awry and that Iran escalated tensions. President Obama, according to the news reports, wanted a non-kinetic means of responding by taking down the power grid of Iran. Why would such a sensitive program be leaked right now? Could it have anything to do with the ground that's changed in the last 6 weeks? Well, I would argue that even if it didn't, it should. The other two facets, just concluding here on this fifth point, further sanctions. You know, sanctions have failed. Why will new sanctions work? Well, we don't know that they will, but we could obviously do more to curb the finances of the Kim family regime, targeting key businesses and people. That was part of a Senate resolution that passed this past week, I believe. Secondary sanctions on companies doing business can certainly be possible. This is something that could look like Bank of Delta Asia, which a very provocative, controversial step undertaken in the last decade. Is being looked at again. And I think cutting down on the global illicit trade is a law enforcement measure that could be enacted with the help of countries like Japan that stepped up right away, which is what led the North Koreans, by the way, to abandon the abductee issue now, which was a joke because the North Koreans had plenty of chances to come clean on the abductee issue and just drag the Japanese along and along and along. And now they claim they're ending this because the Japanese are stepping up to put international pressure on North Korea. Finally, the military deterrent and defense efforts. This is a critical backbone of these issues. So we've seen F-22 stealth fighters, nuclear capable, fly off Korea Peninsula this week. We saw a B-52 bomber come in from Guam last month after the nuclear test. We see a ready talk about adding another layer of missile defense, THAAD, battery in particular. These are not necessarily the fundamental solution that President Park laid out in her speech. Maybe there is no fundamental solution that we and statesmen and stateswomen can control. But inaction has consequences too. I would only say that even though we're in a very dark period of inter-Korean relations and a very fraught time, that engagement will survive, must survive, and eventually, after we also strengthen deterrence and defense, we're going to have to come back to engagement. But we're not going to do that right away. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Scott, over to you.
Okay, well, Patrick gave such an interesting presentation that I'm going to have to completely change what I was going to say.
Good. We're all nimble on our feet.
You know, in part because I think that, you know, I want to give a little bit of counterpoint. You know, keeping in mind that weeks before German unification, nobody thought it was going to happen. I guess the theme of what I would have to say is the more things change, the more they stay the same. And when it comes to looking at Korean history, there's nothing that stands out more than the role of genealogy. And so I think that it's important to look back at the fact that this inter-Korean competition has been going on, hot war 50 to 53, and then an international competition for legitimacy that has been endemic to the relationship between North and South Korea. And it turns out that Park Geun-hye's father and Kim Jong-un's grandfather, the father and grandfather of the two current leaders, you know, also were playing this game kind of at each other's throats in various ways. But then they actually made the first inter-Korean agreement back in 1972. And, you know, what were the circumstances that led to the agreement? Well, actually, it was the Nixon opening to China. And so the point I just want to make is that the great power relationship between the US and China frames the inter-Korean relationship and can be a driver. Now, I think we're in a different circumstance in terms of what is happening right now. It's actually ironic. It seems like Park Geun-hye is trying to be the driver, pulling the US and China along. And then, of course, the other aspect is that in the 1970s, the North was the stronger party, and the South was the weaker party. And Park Chung-hee, Park Geun-hye's father, spent a lot of time worrying about actually US abandonment and North Korean threat. Today, Park Geun-hye is in the driver's seat as the stronger party, and the North Koreans are the ones who are vulnerable. And of course, that has been one of the drivers for the acquisition of the asymmetric threat, the nuclear silver bullet that now has become a part of legitimization of Kim Jong-un, makes it even harder to get him to unclench his fist with the nuclear weapons in it because his legitimacy depends on it. And so what has happened over the course of the past few weeks? Well, what is striking to me is actually, maybe this is just a real quick capsule of recent history, but in mid-December we had a very interesting event with a girls band in Beijing that didn't get to play and at the same time inter-Korean talks. And in both cases, the message to Kim Jong-un was, we oppose North Korea's acquisition of a nuclear capability. We oppose Kim Jong-un's announcement of a hydrogen bomb. The girls came back from Beijing, and 3 days later, apparently, Kim Jong-un signed the order for a nuclear test. What was he doing? He was showing that he had alternatives to negotiation. And so I think that the key in terms of reading Park Geun-hye's speech is actually, it's encapsulated, my favorite phrase as related to aspirations related to North Korea is regime transformation, because it's ambiguous. It could mean making North Korea change, or it could be changing North Korea. But essentially the task that the international community has before it, as a result of what Kim Jong-un has done, with the nuclear test and a missile test, is actually to say to the North Koreans, actually, you don't have an alternative to negotiation. And so I think that what Park Geun-hye, you know, one possibility is that she's trying to drive North Korea back to negotiations. But in order to do that, you have to put North Korea's survival at risk. You have to show Kim Jong-un that having these nuclear weapons is actually more dangerous to the survival of the regime than not having nuclear weapons. It's actually the only way that you can get back to a negotiation path. Now, you know, either way, in terms of regime transformation, you know, ultimately either way works in terms of, you know, potentially getting you to denuclearization, North Korea changing their mind or North Korea being forced to change their mind. But one is more costly than the other, because the other key phrase, I think, when we talk about unification that I think we tend to move past is peaceful coexistence. And the main attraction of the German case is that it was a peaceful process. And I think that that is what the international community and the Koreas, you know, and the South Koreans aspire to, but increasingly, because of the steps that Kim Jong-un has taken, it looks much more difficult to be able to achieve this peacefully. And so Park Geun-hye, I think, has basically laid it on the line. She's given Kim Jong-un a challenge, but she's also given the U.S. and China a challenge to see whether they can follow her lead and make this the existential moment for Kim Jong-un.
Scott, thank you very much for that. And thank you for one thing in particular that you said, and that is that in order to get the North Koreans to focus on denuclearization, one needs to put at risk the thing that they hold most valuable, which is the continued existence of their regime, the preservation of their system. I've spent literally thousands of hours across the table from the North Koreans over the years and came to that conclusion about 5 or 6 years ago. And I'm hearing it echoed more and more, including by people in the U.S. administration, but also by colleagues in Seoul. It's not meant to be a threat. It's not meant to be a threat, certainly, of bringing down the regime or changing the regime. But it is meant to remind the North Koreans that they are running risks, risks that under normal circumstances would be unacceptable to them. And so by going back at the North Koreans and saying that if you continue down this path, you will lose the thing that you have always said is the most precious thing to you, I think it has the effect of focusing their attention. Lots of references to President Park Geun-hye's speech. We all have our theories and our interpretations, but we are fortunate to have a definitive South Korean government view here. And let me turn the mic over to Ambassador Kim for his thoughts and his interpretations and his evaluations.
Okay, thank you. Evans. I think my government is more focused on sanction against North Korea than unification. Actually, unification is the ultimate goal, but my government is currently focused on how to build up effective and comprehensive sanction against North Korea so that North Korea give up nuclear tests and ambitions. And just they give up their Pyongjin policy. They pursue nuclear weapons and economic development together. But as the distinguished panelist pointed out, my president made a speech to National Assembly yesterday, and she outlined her determination and priorities in dealing with North Korea. Actually, she decided to give up the decade-old, more than decade-old peace project, Kaesong Industrial Complex. This is a really, really symbolic show of how determined she is. And my government, how determined my government is to change North Korea. Otherwise, there is a certain urgency and also a certain feeling of unexpected development of crisis in our region.
So she's quite determined to show her leadership in building up tough sanctions. Particularly, she is focused on how to engage China into tougher measures of sanction against North Korea. Actually, my foreign minister visited New York Security Council last week. She met with 15 ambassadors of Security Council members, and he discussed the ways to build up effective and strong sanction against North Korea in the Security Council. But as you see, since Security Council discussed this issue early January, they are still ongoing. Well, this is a very important process. This is a kind of guidance of sanctions in the international community. So we need to build up very strong sanction at the Security Council. On top of that, we need add individual sanctions against North Korea. So, for example, United States Congress passed the North Korean Sanction Enforcement Act last week. I think this week President Obama will sign it into law. Then I think it'll make a very strong bilateral sanctions punishing the third countries who trade or deal with North Korean entities. So this will make a very good backdrop. And also Japan joined individual bilateral sanctions. As my president emphasized in our address to National Assembly yesterday, close down of Kaesong Industrial Complex is a leadership by example, how to build sanctions against North Korea on the international level. At the same time, we are considering introducing a missile defense in Korean Peninsula. The THAAD is the terminal high altitude area defense system. And actually, my president announced this is a matter of national security, and also it needs to be negotiated considering security and national interest. So I think there's some urgency to introduce some effective missile defense on top of the current KAMD system. So this is also a shift to tough measures, a tough determination to North Korea. Of course, we are doing some loudspeaker offensives at the same time, so long ago. So this is quite a shift, as Patrick mentioned, but I think this is an extension of the trust politic, because trust politic has two aspects. One is a very tough face, is a deterrence and sanctions, and then the other is engagement and dialogue. But we pursued the dialogue path for a long time, but the situation, recent situation, and particularly with the new leadership, Kim Jong-un, he's very unpredictable. He's cruel to his loyalist followers, and nobody checks him in a very reasonable path. This is a kind of urgency and feeling of crisis. So she just summarized her priorities and determination in an address to National Assembly yesterday. These days, not only sanction but also the possibility of collapse in North Korea is being raised very frequently, not only in Korea experts or in a media. So that means the young leadership, Kim Jong-un of North Korea, sounds absurd. I mean, abnormal, because his leadership, his government sounds a little bit out of normal, because the even he persecuted, purged chief of staff, military chief of three times in 4 years. First, he executed Lee Young-ho, the military chief of staff, and then Hyun Young-cho, is military chief of staff, and then defense minister. He was executed for small mistake. And recently, Lee Young-gil, the same chief of staff, executed for corruption charges. So this makes the situation in North Korea very unpredictable. And also, nobody checks him, in a reasonable past, as I mentioned. So perhaps the collapse of North Korea is an issue. And our aim to engage China into not only into sanctions, but also some good preparation for a possibility of collapse of North Korea. This is also our goal we pursue with China. This is my brief thoughts on this important issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. You've raised all sorts of issues and topics together with those of the other colleagues on the stage here, including the role of China. We've talked about sanctions. We've talked about internal political developments in the North. And I'm going to want to get to all of that during our discussions here. And I'm sure when we get to the audience Q&A period, people will have lots of questions about all those things. Let me throw out a question to you, Mr. Ambassador. I've always found over the years working as a diplomat that it's helpful to put yourself in the other guy's shoes and try to understand things the way he or she understands things when you're confronted with a delicate situation like the one that we're obviously in right now. So imagine you're sitting in Pyongyang and you are the leader you're in the leadership circle, and what you see happening is the shutdown of one of the most high-profile examples of North-South cooperation, a facility that was employing 55,000 North Korean workers. These 55,000 North Korean workers had access to three good, wholesome meals a day, daycare, medical care. There was even a small 7-Eleven market where they could buy various things. They had heat, electricity, all those things that many North Koreans don't have. And $100+ million a year was being put into North Korea's bank accounts as part of this arrangement, and now it's gone. And so those 55,000 workers and their families and extended families are now without this income stream. The regime, which took most of that salary in any event, is without that income stream. So you see that happening. And then on Tuesday, Kim Jong-un turns on his television set and sees a speech, an almost unprecedented speech by a South Korean president, essentially reversing course. And saying that all of those things that we have tried with North Korea have failed. I'm simplifying, but that's essentially what her message was. And she comes very close to using a phrase that has a certain political baggage, regime change. She didn't use the phrase, but she came very close to using it. If you're sitting in Pyongyang, how do you see this situation? And how do you respond to it?
Well, Kim Jong-un is no doubt is making a very bad language about my president. Lowest terms.
If but you use the Korean, I'll translate for you.
But I don't want to repeat that. Actually, this is this is an unthinkable, way of expression when you, mention. The leaders you don't like. I mean, this is the lowest, term, language. So But you know, when you go up to the border, demilitarized zone, I mean, they also making some loudspeaker offensives. Our loudspeaker is much more effective, reach much more distance. But the our broadcast is on you know, very practical information, how the North Kim Jong Un mislead North Korea, and some fact-based, you know, information. His unreasonable leadership and some kind of madness and absurdity. But this is very rational. I mean, very gentle and practical. While their loudspeaker speaks from start to end and just bad language about our leadership. So this is the situation. And no doubt he would not be happy. And also, she's making very strong move, unthinkable move, when closing down Kaesong Industrial Complex. I mean, this is no doubt this is a source of income. Actually, it's annually it generated more than $100 million, and in total so far, $560 million. You know, just paid to the regime, not to the workers. So only 30% of wages paid in terms of in North Korean currencies and some other vouchers. But 70% of dollar just went to the Workers' Party. There's an office 39 and also some secretary office, which deals with leadership, you know, funds. So that means leadership funds used for, you know, weapon program, missile and nuclear and missile programs, and all his leadership projects, and also some expensive products. I mean, that is a finding, and there is a reason why we need to close down. And the other thing is we have supplied electricity and some water to Kaesong area, and also cut off. But I don't think this cut off electricity and water doesn't make any serious problems to the population in Kaesong, because they have their own system as well, though not very effective.
Thank you very much. Mr. Ambassador, in your remarks earlier, you talked a bit about internal developments, the executions, the purges that are going on in the north. Let me ask our other two panelists if they could share their perspective on what I think is a critically important question, which is, how do you assess internal stability in North Korea? Are these executions a manifestation of the strength and the fact that Kim Jong-un is in control? Or are these executions and purges and other steps that he's taking evidence that all is not necessarily well in North Korea? Patrick, you want to start off on that one?
Sure. It's a great imponderable question from when you're looking from the outside. I think that Kim Jong-un is mostly number one, and he wants to be number two, number three, number four, number five, and number six. In so doing, he is sowing the seeds of some potential prospect of a palace coup that I mentioned. Is it probable? No. It's impossible to quantify the possibility of it until it happens, or if it happens. I think Scott rightly pointed to essentially, although he didn't use the word, the no landing scenario, peaceful coexistence scenario, minus the peace, is being maybe the continuation of where we've been. And that still remains the most probable scenario. But clearly there's more risk. I'd be very curious to know what happens to essentially 1/6 of the elite of North Korea if you think about the families that are touched by the workers at Kaesong, who now go on North Korean unemployment versus the hot showers in the 7-Eleven. you know, again, I don't want to be too glib, but the point is, those people really did have expectations for a better future. That those expectations are now dashed in the foreseeable future, potentially. So that becomes at least a source, a headache for Kim Jong-un. Not necessarily a loss of power, but one more headache. I think on the revenue side, though, you know, North Korea is very good at finding alternative sources of revenue. I refer to the illicit sort of network. I mean, we can't prove that Iran is funneling hundreds of millions of dollars potentially, but now that Iran is in the money, it can afford to offshore some of its missile development, if not nuclear development. What better place to offshore to a place like North Korea? That could easily overwhelm. That's why I think the ambassador's comments were right, that the Kaesong is meant to embolden the international community. You know, here's what we're doing. What are you going to do now to help on this? If we're really going to try to tighten the screws to Kim Jong-un and face that existential crisis, the problem, I think, ultimately, remains China. But Scott maybe can inform us on why we should be more optimistic that China is going to have more political will than they've shown. Anyway, Scott, you set me right.
Okay, well, so you're actually asking me a different question from the one that Evans asked.
Let's get your take on internal stability, and then I want to ask everybody for their take on China.
Yeah. So we used to have a very interesting debate with Kim Jong-il about whether Kim Jong-il was in charge or whether the military was in charge. And actually, that was a much more dynamic debate, I think, than we have now, because Kim Jong-un is... is somebody who clearly is demoting and firing and killing. And in a way, I think that the problem is he's deviated from the old formula. Because basically, the way that it used to be done is you banished an official to the countryside for a period of time, and then they got rehabilitated. But if you kill him, you can't rehabilitate him, and you make real enemies, right? So it's clear that he is powerful. And he's ruling by fear. The problem, I think, that really makes him different from his father and his grandfather is that he's also peerless. And what I mean by that is that his grandfather and his father had cadres that grew up with them, that fought with them in the Japanese, you know, war, or that were his classmates in the case of Kim Jong-il. But Kim Jong-un was kind of off in his own world in Switzerland for a while, and you look at pictures of him with his generals, and it's pretty clear everybody's afraid. You know, nobody can tell him what he needs to hear. And so that's a problem also for diplomacy, because he's self-isolating, and nobody has a channel. The Chinese, I don't think they've got a channel. The Russians don't have a channel. Nobody really, and so as a result, we're resorting to, you know, very blunt signaling, you know, B-2s and F-22s and all this kind of, you know, signaling to try to tell Kim Jong-un, look, here's the line, please stop. And it's not clear what it's going to take for him to get the right message.
I want to spend a few minutes talking about the 1,800-pound gorilla, which is China, and its relations with its only treaty ally, North Korea. A very complicated and difficult relationship. For those of you who are academics and students in the audience, I encourage you to look at a lot of the Eastern European archive materials that have been declassified over the years, and you'll find some remarkable things in those archives that underscore the incredible complexity of the China-North Korea relationship from day one. This has been a relationship fraught with contradictions and complications, and it's only gotten even more so. But let me tee this up by saying that if you're sitting in Beijing and looking at the Korean Peninsula, you see that your nominal treaty ally, the DPRK, North Korea, has consistently dissed you, insulted you, humiliated you, made your envoys look like fools. They go to Pyongyang, they have meetings, they appear on the days with Kim Jong-un, they come back home, you fire off a nuclear weapon, and you don't even ask give a buy or leave to the Chinese. You have seen, for example, as happened the other day, China's special envoy for North Korean affairs and the six-party talks went to Pyongyang in the footsteps of another senior official. And literally hours after his visit, they fired off the missile. You have seen the security dynamics in the region moving in a much more dangerous direction if you're Chinese. You see new military deployments taking place thanks to North Korea, reaction to North Korean actions, new military deployments by the United States, et cetera, F-22s, et cetera, THAAD deployment now being discussed, the anti-missile deployments. None of these things, if you're sitting in Beijing, are in your interests. Yet, the Chinese are making it fairly clear that they are not prepared to be cooperative with the United States and the ROK and Japan and others in the Security Council in putting in place the sort of UN Security Council resolution that we would like to see. What is the Chinese calculus? What's going on in their minds, Mr. Ambassador?
Well, it's a very speculative. It is very speculative, you know, for a diplomat to speak on undecided China policy. So this is a purely a speculative and also my personal views. I have no instruction from my government. So, but to be sure, I mean, I think China will join sanction, unprecedented sanction, but how tough is the matter? I mean, did China think of North Korea as strategic? I mean, even though North Korea is embarrassment, has been embarrassment every time, but China cannot give up the value of North Korea strategically buffer state. But this is a known fact. I mean, everybody agrees on that, even though China disagrees. I mean, we agree on that. I'm hearing from my colleagues that the China would like to join, but China wants to do not want to have North Korea collapse because of the sanction. China emphasizes three principles, as you know, denuclearization, peace and security on the peninsula, and engagement with dialogue. So, but we tried six-party talks, failed, but we found North Korea nuclear armed and sharpening their missile technologies, targeting everywhere, including United States. So I think China is pondering how to make the sanction effective, but not to the level jeopardize the collapse. But this is my observation, and also we exchange views with China. Actually, we had a Vice Foreign Minister's strategic dialogue in Seoul this week. And we discussed the detailed measures of sanction China can join. And we urged them to join just the sanction we want to see China join. So, this is a very meticulous ongoing discussions on these issues. On the other hand, the collapse can happen. I think China may think North Korea could collapse without any additional sanctions. But if some bilateral sanction built up, then I think North Korean economy is so weak and the situation is so bad, they could collapse. So China cannot control the possibility of collapse of North Korea. But when collapse happens, we need to engage China, convinced South Korea-led unification is acceptable option, though not a best option for them. But this is the aspect we want to enlarge. So I think that is one of the reasons my president visited China last year, early September. So this is my assessment on China.
Thank you. Scott, your take on China?
Yeah. Well, in a way, there's nothing more humbling for a rising China than to have North Korea as a neighbor. And I think that one thing that we see is that, you know, in the United States, all the analysts think that China is the key. If you're in Beijing, all the analysts think that the U.S. is the key. And I think the reason why they think the U.S. is the key is that when they look at the Korean Peninsula, they're always thinking about the United States. And the thing that they fear is unification on South Korean terms with a U.S. ally. And so basically, for China to support unification, what they need is a unification on China's terms, basically. They want a peninsula that is friendly to China. And the current conditions are adverse. And in a way, I think the most frustrating thing for Chinese is that you know, the North Koreans are exploiting the geopolitical situation and taking China for granted, and everybody knows it. And there's nothing that the Chinese feel that they can do about it. And so that's quite humbling, because you've got, you know, this North Korean country that is not gaining respect from China, and yet they're holding so much at risk in terms of China's national interest.
Patrick, your take.
Well, I certainly agree with both speakers. I would add a couple of other thoughts. One of them is from the perspective of looking at U.S. policy. The idea of regime change becoming almost a fetish of U.S. policy under the last administration that I served in became highly discredited. It became a red line issue in Beijing, Moscow, and some other places. And I think we have to particularize, though, North Korea. It's not the same as these other instances, but nonetheless, it's also impossible to separate. It's like striking out that evidence when somebody has just said something in a court of law. Second point I'd say is that China is looking at more or less control. There are other factors too. This is not simply political science, cost-benefit analysis. There's culture and history and geography and many, many more complex things that only are derived by understanding the people and the culture and the language. But still, as the ambassador said, with China fearing a loss of control through instability, it's too high a risk to see regime change. But you could counter that by saying, well, what are they doing with this island building and putting surface air missiles in the South China Sea? Well, they can do that in part because they don't feel like that's going to spin out of control at this point. So even though it's destabilizing from our perspective, at least the U.S. perspective and the perspective of Chinese neighbors, it's not destabilizing inherently the way that going after the existential threat that Kim Jong-un could bring about that kind of massive change. So I just had those 2 points.
I'm going to want to open it up to the audience in just a couple of moments here, but not before asking another terribly unfair question to all three panelists. Keeping in mind our topic today, prospects for Korean reunification, and keeping in mind the amount of political capital that the Republic of Korea under President Park's leadership has invested in this, and all of the efforts that have been made in this ROK administration and previous ROK administrations to achieve some level of reconciliation, to engage in cooperation with the North, to try to wean the North away from its authoritarian, brutal, odd political system that it has. All of those things have happened, and many, 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 many people have worked very hard to create a better atmosphere in which the possibility of reunification might be realized, or at least discussed seriously between North and South. With that background, and in light of events that have transpired now in these last weeks that we've been talking about, are we closer to the day of reunification, or are we further away from that day today than ever? Mr. Ambassador?
Well, this is, you know, is a kind of fortune telling. but this is more related to my wish than telling the future. I think the leadership, North Korean leadership, you know, young, inexperienced, does not give any assurance that this regime will last long. So when you look at the scene, a TV scene of a North Korean leader surrounded by his most loyal you know, followers, they don't dare to sit in front of them. That means his leadership is based on a reign of terror, but I don't think real you know, feeling of loyalty is felt among the most loyal group of people. And so that means on top of that, there is no strong supporters, as mature age supporters. That means Chang Sung-taek and Kim Kyung-hee, uncle and aunt, gone, actually executed. The uncle is executed. And he relies on his younger sister. So I don't think the old aged, mature aged military generals feel very much fear in front of them. That means that makes their sudden development decision against his leadership. Then I think such a contingency, nobody can control it, and we need to secure the nuclear you know, materials and weapons. And I think we have a good room of cooperation. It is everybody's wish to control.
Thank you. I'm reminded of a paper I did a couple of 3 years ago for Brookings, in which I laid out a possible very senior level negotiation between the United States and the DPRK, a new type of negotiation in which we would be dealing directly with the inner circle of leadership in North Korea, direct dialogue, something we've never done before. And I did that paper a few years ago and shared it with some colleagues in Washington. And the other day I took another look at the paper, and I had actually mentioned in an earlier draft of that paper some names of prospective interlocutors that we might engage in North Korea. Every single one of them is dead. Scott, closer or further away than ever?
So what I'm struck by is that in South Korea, there's a striving for unification. There's a song, Our Wish is Unification. There's a lot of focus, you know, on this topic as a matter of policy. There's a Unification Preparation Committee. But one of the most senior Korean former government officials that I can think of, he has always said, unification will come to us. It's not something to strive for. And I think the reason why that is the case is because it's ultimately about North Korea's vulnerability. But the biggest factor that I think that stands in the way is actually still that if you're a North Korean elite, it's better to hang together than to hang separately. And there's no prospect for an alternative life that would be worth living for a North Korean elite in a unified Korea under the South Korean system.
Very good.
We certainly can't forecast unification, but chronologically, we have to be a day closer to unification.
by definition.
By definition. The question is, are we at a turning point? And that's what I raised in my initial points. We don't know. I mean, there was a potential turning point of negotiation when you go back to the failed Leap Day deal. That could have been the third generation of the Kim family regime grasping the nettle of diplomacy and leading toward gradual confederation and peace. That didn't happen. That was a turning point. We're now at a different turning point, a darker one, but maybe it'll have a positive outcome because eventually political goals have to be seized. So I think there are only two points from a policy perspective, especially from the U.S., just to paraphrase my chairman, Kurt Campbell, you've heard this many times. You know, we have two possibilities with dealing with North Korean contingencies. We can be badly prepared, or we can be more badly prepared. So we really have no alternative to the ROK and the United States working closely together on every step of the way and working with good allies in the region like Japan and trying to seek help with China and others to be better prepared for the array of contingencies that could come our way tomorrow.
On that note, I want to turn this conversation that we've been having here into a conversation with you. And so I ask anyone who has a question to please come down. We have microphones set up on either side. Please identify yourself and please do ask questions if at all possible. And feel free to direct your question to any specific member of the panel or to all of us in general. And we will do our best to respond to your thoughts, concerns, and curiosity. This gentleman right here.
Hi, my name's Paul. I'm a student at Fordham University. As Mr. Snyder mentioned, the United States and China are two main drivers towards reunification. Given the recent escalations in the conflicts in the South China Sea between China and Japan, and therefore indirectly or directly with the United States, how does that affect the prospect of reunification and China's willingness to cooperate?
So I think that North Korea lives in the space created by geopolitical mistrust between the U.S. and China. And really, over the course of the past 9 months, or if we go back to 2013, third nuclear test, and think about this nuclear test, what is different? Well, one thing that stands out as different is that in 2013, a new president, Xi Jinping, was looking to have a new type of great power relationship with the United States. And the two leaders, Obama and Xi, agreed that North Korea was a priority for cooperation at their Sunnyland summit. But over the course of the past 6 to 9 months, I mean, all of that has evaporated. There's a different tone in the U.S.-China relationship right now, and so I think that that goes a long way toward explaining why it has been much more difficult this round for the U.S. and China to work together on North Korea than was the case 3 years ago.
Let me just add to that something that came out of a fascinating discussion I had with a young Chinese academic a few days ago, in which I posed that very question to him. And he came back at me with a fascinating answer, and he said, this situation that we have here, he's describing China's posture towards North Korea, is not really about Korea. It's not really about the Korean Peninsula. It's about you and us. And you need to understand, and I had introduced this topic by giving him the list of ways in which the North Koreans had shown disrespect for China. And he said, we take all that on board. We understand that. We know that they're undermining our interests in certain ways. We know that they have nothing but contempt for us, and the feeling is mutual, he said. However, in the grand scheme of things, this is about rising contention, that was the word he used, between the United States and China. And if you look at it in that way, we need North Korea. I thought that was a fascinating answer. I hope that answers your question. Okay. Let's come on inside, please.
My name is Kil Yi. I teach history at Brigham Community College in New Jersey. Thank you for your very thoughtful comment. I have two questions, one for the general panel and one for Mr. Ambassador. Are we not downplaying the military aspect of Kaesong Industrial Complex? It is 8 square kilometers of land situated right in the middle of the line of attack for North Koreans, and it was used in 1950. I mean, that is a huge military breakthrough when that land was bleached, essentially. So now DMZ is discontinuous line for the first time in half century. In order to protect that spot, there used to be nearly one division US forces functioning as so-called tripwire, a sad word, actually. I mean, to use 20,000 American soldiers as tripwire, it's a sad situation. Now, Kaesong Industrial Complex erased, or not erased, but you know, downplayed those necessities, military necessities. So to think that Kaesong Industrial Complex is just funnel of $100 million to the Kim Jong-un's nuclear treasury is somewhat, I think, lopsided view of the asset of the Kaesong Industrial Complex. And I would like to hear your comments. And to follow up, Mr. Ambassador, your country and mine, it's a divided country, North and South Korea. And it's also a fractured society, ideologically speaking. due to President Park's very, very harsh and conservative policy towards North Korea, there are many left-leaning intellectuals as well as students, traditionally the force that have brought changes to Korean society. They are looking at the present regime or administration as moving closer toward the US and Japan-led hegemonic circle in Northeast Asia. And they are going to voice their opposition as well as their anger towards what they perceived as South Korea going back to President Park's father's time when let's kill commies was our national agenda, wasn't it true? Thank you.
Mr. Ambassador, you want to start, and then I'll ask my colleagues to chime in on Kaesong.
I think being a daughter of previous very authoritarian leader, but he's a great leader, he's as well, but he's also criticized as a dictator. So whenever General Xi pursues some very conservative policy line and just the immediate response from the progressive group of Korean society, just she easily accuses her as she's going back to her father's era. I mean, this is it's not a fair appreciation of her leadership at these days. Actually, she's so concerned about the security of the South Korea, because North Korea is so determined to deploy missiles, and not only the nuclear missiles, but also so other ABC is mass destruction weapons. I think it's formidable. So she need to be prepared for this bad situation, I mean, which is escalating because due to bad leadership in North Korea. She's duly warning the all society, not only conservative, but also progressives, that North Korea is a really, really concern we need to prepare for. And at the same time, she needs to deal with a certain bad environment, economic environment South Korea need to face. I mean, sometimes it is linked with some division, ideological division in our society. So she emphasized unity in preparing ourselves for the North Korean threat and also challenges, economic challenges now Korean economy is facing. So she asked for cooperation, bipartisan effort on certain national issues. I mean, she's emphasizing that she's not reverting to her father's era.
Comments on Kaesong, the military dimension?
Certainly. Any tactical advantage that Kim Jong-un's military could derive by emptying Kaesong could be offset by the loss of hostages, something that he has readily used, and even you can be a undergraduate at the University of Virginia and still be a useful political hostage for political purposes for Kim Jong-un. And it's a tactical operational advantage, potentially, of many salients that could be used in a surprise attack with an atrophying conventional force when Kim Jong-un has favored asymmetrical, non-unconventional forces, nuclear weapons, cyber special operations. And it would still be a strategic loss in the short run because of the tight U.S. alliance. That's why we have F-22s flying over. That's why the Senate resolution against North Korea passed unanimously. It was to signal absolutely clearly to North Korea, hopefully, if he's listening, that the United States is a tripwire. We're ready to go into a fight if he wants to start a war. Now, what would happen if we were into a different administration, started to reduce our forces? What would happen if North Korea started to deploy a nuclear ICBM at the US? Would we trade Los Angeles, you know, in this kind of calculation? Those questions at least are being asked. I think we'd still be there. But if you start to erode deterrence and extended deterrence, then that conventional scenario becomes maybe more salient over time. But right now in the short term, not that key, I think.
Yeah, I'll just say a word really about the non-military aspect of this, because, you know, US and DPRK also had a cooperative project with over nuclear issues back in the 1990s. And you know, when those sorts of projects are lost, those are, you know, opportunities that are lost for joint cooperation. And in the case of Kaesong, it was actually a form of mutual vulnerability, I think, because of the hostage issue. And so, you know, it's very costly. It pushes North and South Korea further apart. And I'm very sad to see that, but it's also a necessity.
That's a good point. I would just add as a footnote to this, I was actually in the Republic of Korea serving as a diplomat when the concept of Kaesong was first being discussed, and I was part of the team that was put together, an ROK US team, to assess whether this was a good or a bad idea. And one of the arguments that I remember making in those initial meetings was very similar to the point that was just made by that gentleman. And that is, as we looked, we stood there at the DMZ and looked at this open expanse of empty space where, in a wartime scenario, North Korean armored divisions would come storming through. And I turned to one of my military colleagues and said, are you going to tell me that we're going to put a major factory complex right in the middle of where those tanks would have to come through? And I said, that sounds like a good idea to me. And my military colleagues readily agreed with it. But I would also agree with the points that have been made, particularly by Patrick a little bit earlier, that maybe the best value of Kaesong will come in shutting it down and removing from the North Koreans the income, the opportunity, the hopes, and the aspirations. And in the minds and the hearts of those North Koreans, they will feel a certain level of resentment. Some of that will obviously be directed at Seoul, but I would argue that a lot of it is going to be directed at their own leadership. Another question.
Yes, thank you. My name is Chris Barnes. I'm currently firmly residing in graduate school application limbo for international affairs and foreign service. Thank you, gentlemen, for a fascinating panel. And my question is, setting aside the prospects for Korean reunification and focusing on denuclearization, obviously China is going to play an integral part, if not the most fundamental part, of any achievable outcome in that situation. And given that they are working so strenuously over the past years and decades to achieve a, you could say, a higher status in the geopolitical arena, is it conceivable that if not the United States, perhaps the ROK goes to them to try to draw them into that situation, essentially giving them the idea to have themselves to find a solution to this problem that they can take credit for, as would befit the status of a great power, which could then allow them to say, we've done this great thing for the world, we deserve the recognition, the credit, the prestige and respect. Does that seem possible, or do they not seem like they'd be willing to go that far, as you stated, because they need North Korea?
Can you toss that out to the panel, please? Anybody?
Now, I think we're actually at a moment where the South Koreans had invested quite a bit in trying to improve the relationship with Beijing, and at least for the time being, I think they're feeling like they didn't get as much as they had hoped. And this is recurrent. We saw the same thing in 2010. But, you know, let me also step back, because the premise of the question is really about, over the course of the past two decades, we've seen a tremendous change. Back in the 1990s, China was actually not really terribly relevant to a lot of the discussions that we're having about the peninsula, and now they are playing a critical role. One interesting case study, I think, was in the mid-2000s, we set up this six-party framework, which was an implicit admission that the U.S. couldn't solve it by itself, but also it gave the Chinese an opportunity, and they also found that they couldn't, you know, push the ball over the line. And so it's true that, in a way, time is on China's side, but the peninsula is a very difficult challenge, precisely in a way because of the historical baggage of the Korea-China relationship when China was the Middle Kingdom.
Any other?
The relations with China is an important priority in our diplomatic goals. So far we agreed on strategic partnership relations with China, actually, which covers not only economic but also some strategic aspects. But basically, our relations with China is decided. Simply put, could be seriously influenced by relations of United States and China. So if United States and China get along well, I think there is some good aspect of our role in that regard. But if two countries' relations get sour, and really it's a matter of when we are facing some critical time of decision, then all consideration does not go in the same direction, but we have to put off for better timing to address the issue. So actually it is more interaction, two major powers, but United States doesn't like the idea of two major powers. I mean, actually this is China wants to have unite with the United States, but there is some aspiration. There is for elevated status of China in global affairs. I mean, discussing good, important issues with the United States. This is a good aspect of China's aspiration. I think we can expand that aspect and engage China into more rule-based path. Yeah.
Thank you. One last question, please.
Is there a way for a unified Korea to pledge to be neutral? I like, you know, Switzerland, because clearly, if not for China, North Korea would have gone the way of Iraq and Libya. But China's the one which is keeping the U.S. from acting. Now, China will not like Korea, which is aligned with the U.S. or with the West. So I think the way out of the impasse is for Korea to somehow pledge to be neutral, like Switzerland, and then China would have no grounds or no reason for objecting, because as you know, we all know China once saved North Korea, and it's actually what's keeping North Korea around. But without, you know, something like that,
thank you,
if it can help it, China will not go along.
A neutral Korea. Yeah,
I think Patrick has this.
I think we have some strong views, but Patrick, let's give you the last word.
Well, my reading on neutralization schemes come from my wife's research, starting at Oxford Graduate School more than three decades ago when she wrote the book on the Austrian State Treaty, which took more than a decade of painstaking negotiations among the major powers, especially the Soviet Union and the United States. At the end of the day, the major powers basically imposed neutralization. We're not dealing with a post-war situation in the case of the Republic of Korea. We're dealing with a very vibrant, strong democracy. They have a voice of their own. They don't really want to be told by other powers what their disposition ought to be. I think left to their own devices, we can ask the ambassador, Korea would like to be able to successfully manage good relations with all the major powers, like most countries. But that doesn't mean they want to give up a close military security relationship with the United States. So, the Koreans have a voice in this. It's not something that major powers come in and say, you know, neutralization is the path. Neutralization is very difficult to enact. It's an idea that they talk about at the United Nations. It's not an idea that capitals really seize with great fervor most of the time. So it sounds better than it is. In our report on solving long division, though, we do argue that, yes, there are different orientations of a post-United Korea. And it would probably be different from the current orientation of South Korea-U.S. relationship, but we'd like to preserve a lot of aspects of that in terms of its democracy, free market approach, as well as very solid relations with the United States.
So to add, it's a very pertinent views.
Perhaps the presence of U.S. forces, is very important, not only counter North Korean threats, but also after unification. I think there is balancing player, rivalries of powers in our region. Japan and China is natural rivals. I mean, for hegemony and also some global issues, they have their very constructive, competition in leadership. I mean, so all these situations, I think the United States could make a very beneficial role as a balancer. And so I think we can discuss these issues further, but I don't think the United States forces in Korea after unification is this beneficial to China.
That'll have to be the last word, except let me use the prerogative of having the mic and being in the chair here just to add that a free, democratic, market-oriented republic, United Republic of Korea, living next door to a country of 1.4 billion people, is probably going to want to have some sort of insurance policy. And I would argue that the United States is the best insurance policy that the Republic of Korea has ever had. On that note, I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank you for your attention, your excellent questions, and I hope we've enlightened you. Thank you very much.